been a long time.
Since we last spoke.
Quite a lean and very lean period, but you know, as most actors go through, it's not you know, it's not something to be ashamed of or embarrassed about. But you know, one's career goes through peaks and troughs, and it is a roundabout, a helter-skelter, a roller coaster.
Roundabout, helter-skelter, roller coaster.
Yeah, you know, it's well, not quite all the fun at the fair. You know, it's been more of a, you know, chamber of horrors, really. But you keep your head above water, and then suddenly you get an opportunity to work in a place like this again, which, you know, for any actor in the world would jump at the chance to be here. You know, it's the National Theatre. It's a place where everybody wants to work. From the minute you walk through the door in this building, you feel like you're welcomed into some kind of welcoming womb of,
really?
And it's a massive creativity, it's a massive energy, it's hugely positive. It's a building that likes to say yes, and in my experience, most buildings like to say no. And the opportunity to work with people that facilitate that dynamic are few and far between. You certainly don't get it driving a cab.
Yes. And so what are you actually here for? What are you doing?
I'm part of this new initiative that was set up by management here to keep actors on longer than normal contracts. So it's hugely exciting, but it does mean that I've had to make a commitment for a considerable period of time. Not sure about all the shows that we're performing in yet. The point of this contract is that it's for 10 years.
10 years?
Which is, you know, an extraordinary opportunity. I mean, you know, I spoke to lots of fellow actors who think that it's limiting, that it will stifle your creativity. I don't see it that way. I see it's only something positive. There are incredible people that I'm going to be working around. Some idiots, but mainly incredible people that I'll be working around. And, you know, the minute as an actor that you think you're going to stop learning,
yes,
from other people, you might as well give up. The whole point is that you grow and mature.
Have you been, I'm sorry to ask, have you actually been promised any actual performance?
No, that's the thing. No, I mean, you know, 10 years, you're going to be doing something interesting within that time.
You know that for certain?
Well, the law of averages, you're going to be doing something interesting. I mean, if I wasn't working here, I'd be doing something interesting. So the chance of not doing something interesting in a building like this, remote.
Yeah.
I've heard that I might get to understudy in a production, a major understudy, in a new play by Mira Sayal, but I don't know him.
So this is
what's the landing? Really, there's nothing much goes on here. It's full of techies and things.
Union, what it's worth. Union stuff. Oh, it's the bar. You want to have a look in the bar?
So what's your sort of day then? You come in at 6 o'clock in the morning?
Yeah, I'm quite early. Well, sometimes. No, it's not quite six, but 6:30, 7 to 7.
And is that for a reason? I mean, why did you come in so early?
Essentially, I have to help with the education department set up some of the mail outs. It's complicated. There's a whole union thing about whether or not it's demarcation, whether I should be doing it, whether I shouldn't be doing it.
Equity are quite clear about.
Yeah, they've been quite clear about it. Well, as clear as they can be. You've got people, you know, actors trying to run a union. It's jobs of the boys often, you know. What they're essentially saying is that I shouldn't be using the franking machine. They don't mind me taking part in the education activities and stuffing envelopes is fine. But using a franking machine to them is, and I don't see the distinction. I don't see the difference. I mean, as it is, I come in here every morning and make sure this is all tidied up, and actors can leave a mess the night before, I can tell you. But we all have to take a turn doing this. I'm not going to be the only actor that has to do this sort of work.
No. Right.
That's what they said.
Yeah. So you're quite determined.
Well, we're a company. We're a company.
Right.
And as such, we should all pull together. So if I come in here and the night before Alan Bennett's left his quiche on the table, then I'll move it. Because in a month's time, you know, Adrian Lester could be cleaning up my Diet Coke. Quiet corridor, which I've never quite understood. The last thing you want to be when you're an actor is quiet. You know, you want to really rage.
Yeah.
That good, you know, shuffling off quiet. There's all sorts of stuff. There's like a quiet meditation room here where you can do Alexander technique. You get you get free sessions when you're here.
How many?
Well, you get. Sorry, I didn't say how many. You get, well, I think you get six, but they're free. Sorry, free.
Oh, three?
No, you get six sessions, but they're free. You don't pay for them. There you go. It's the quiet room. If you wanted to be quiet, you can't. It's locked. Yes, we, I mean, everywhere you go, there are... It's just inspiring to work in a building where, well, there's music. And great work.
Isn't that a bit... I mean, having music in what is meant to be a quiet passage. Or is it a quiet passage of music?
There are people dancing. Yeah. So it's probably something... I think we ought to... I don't think we ought to film it, because I think it might be something to do with Katie Mitchell. We can try and go through.
This is, of course, where your
the vocal technique.
This is,
well, now you get to see. This is where you would start your consonant. Your vowel would move through the auditorium to the vomitorium on the other side.
Which seat?
Well, from here. From F. F is where you, if you go from F.
F.
And you go to F over here, you have to start a consonant elongated. We've discussed it, elongate a vowel and finish with a consonant. Yeah. If I was saying duck, you can't go duck. Nobody would hear you. You'd have to go... You'd have to go duck or duck.
But is... You see, this is interesting. Because by the time you reach k, the duh has gone.
No, the intensity of the sentence, depending on what you're saying, the intensity of the, it's about writing. If it's Pinter,
it's always about writing.
It's always about the text.
It's always the text.
Usually about the text. Can be about the actor. Depends on the actor. So this is these are the dressing rooms for the Olivier. This is the Cottesloe Theatre here. Not sure what's on at the moment. Set up for something or other. Scene of one of my biggest, well, other people would say triumphs. In this space, in this beautiful black box that we call the Cottesloe. Did you see it?
No, I don't think I did. What was it?
Peter Pan.
Peter Pan?
Yes.
And you played?
Smee.
Smee?
Yeah.
Yes, you'd be very good. Mm-hmm. small theatre for such a large...
Well, it was scaled down eventually for educational touring budget. Took it out there to lots of people. Other people got to see it, not just a metropolitan audience. Lots of other people got to share in it. There was no flying. There's nowhere to fly in here. Well, you bang your head. Baskets everywhere. But
These baskets, they're permanent, are they?
Well, they were here last time I said. I don't know why they're here, actually, but they were up there last time I was in. I think they're just to keep... They do a lot of work with the elderly during the day. I think they bring them in and cheers them up. The disabled.
Now, this production of Peter Pan...
Yes.
I don't recall... When was this?
1991.
Ah.
You remember it? It didn't end well.
Oh?
No.
Oh, was this the one...
Where Tinkerbell got pregnant. She was only 16. I mean, you know, it's not illegal, but she was only 16, and to all intents and purposes, a minor.
Tinkerbell is normally a light.
A what?
Tinkerbell doesn't appear in Peter Pan. It's a spotlight.
Really?
Can you see me?
No.
Can you see me?
No.
Can you see me? Can you see me?
Ah.
Can you see me? Wait. Can you see me? Can you see me? Can you see me? Can you see me? Now you see me. It's a sweet spot. Now you see me, yeah?
Yes.
I mean, you can see me from there, but now you see me. Now. Yeah?
Yeah.
Ooh-ha, yeah?
Yes.
And what's the difference?
I can see you.
It's like magic.
There's actually a picture of me for some time ago. We painted this mural.
Helped to paint this to brighten up the corridor.
But I think there's a picture of... Where's a picture of... Yes, along here. In happier days. It was wonderful. It did very well, but it's one of those, I didn't work for about, 5 years after this show.
Really? Yes. I'm surprised.
Well, so was I. It was a great production. I thought we did some interesting work. Trevor Nunn directed it. He was artistic director of the building at the time. And I didn't work again for quite some time. We did have quite a heated debate about him asking me to lose some weight. And I decided not to. And
was this the result?
Of losing weight?
Well, of the argument. Did they tease you? It looks like they're teasing you.
Does it?
I see, this is from the production. I thought this was on the South Bank.
No, that was in the show. Does it look like they're teasing me?
I thought those were your work clothes.
Oh.
I didn't realise it was a production photograph. How interesting.
Anyway, it's probably not important. It's
Oh yes, when you're a jet all the way.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a great musical.
Yeah. So if we just go in the dressing room. Radar. Lights on. Do you have enough light? Do you have enough light?
Yes, I think we have enough light.
Very glamorous. I'll put some more light on. Hang on. There we go. Dressing rooms. Basic. Functional. Utilitarian. As opposed to totalitarian. Some people think this building is, and it really isn't. It's a wonderful... wonderful place for an opportunity. This is where everybody hangs out. I think Zoe Wanamaker
was. Is she hanging out at the moment?
No, she's not. Her flowers need watering.
Somebody ought to do that.
It's interesting why... particularly older actors, not women so much. Maybe they go deaf, I don't know. But older actors feel that they have... their right to silence is somehow more important than my right to noise.
Yes, that is an interesting
because
point.
Because they both cross-infect. You see, yes, I know I'm cross-infecting them with noise if they have right, but if they have right to silence, they cross-infect my right to noise.
Have you brought this up at all?
I had a terrible rap.
I'm slightly confused.
What? What with?
Everything.
Okay. What would you like me to explain?
I'm still slightly at a loss as to what you actually do here. I mean, you've shown me the stage, the
yeah.
Olivier stage.
Yeah.
You talked a lot about the day-to-day sort of...
I thought... it's okay, I understand what you're saying. I just thought you got it.
Well,
Are
you employed here as an actor?
Well, yes, but see, I thought you'd seen through. See, what we've been offered here over these 10 years is not conventional in any sense. It's at the coalface of modern theatre practice. So, I mean, who says that an actor is just someone that goes on stage and acts? Who says that?
Well, isn't that the definition?
Yeah, but whose definition? An assumed definition. Now, what this place is about, and why it's so wonderful, is that those roles can be redefined. And one's sense of what status may or may not be can be redefined. For example, some actors who aren't quite as... perhaps experimental and bold as myself, might feel that some of the tasks that I'm asked to do here are beneath them or not about being an actor. They wouldn't push a mop about.
Ah, now we're getting to the nub of it, aren't we?
Are we? You're employed as a
janitor.
No. Listen. You do the play The Caretaker, somebody's playing a caretaker. That doesn't mean that they are a caretaker.
And are
they're
you
just
playing...
a bloke who's lost his mind from Watford.
Right, but are you playing the caretaker?
Well, where does it begin and end? I mean, okay, here's the point. I never have to clean anything, or move anything, or reset anything, or lay out anything that isn't in one of the three theatres here. For example, I don't do it out in the canteen or the green room. That would be for normal people. That would be for proper cleaners. You know, there's an aesthetic which is set up within a space, within a black box such as the Cottesloe, that only people of an artistic aesthetic should really be allowed to work there and in whatever sense it is. And I get to understudy, so I mean...
Oh, you do?
In a conventional sense. I see what you're saying. Okay, it's very dull, isn't it? But, you know, convention. But in a conventional sense, yes, I do get to do some of the stuff that conventionally you would assume an actor to do, like going on a stage.
Oh, really?
Yes.
What are you in at the moment?
Well, I'm not in anything at the moment. Nothing's opened yet, and there's stuff in the pipeline.
But the theatres are full. There are shows in every theatre.
This is a 10-year experiment that I've signed up for, that we've signed up for. I'm not alone in this. Most of the other people that have signed up for it are younger and straight out of drama school. And I think, reading between the lines, the reason I've been brought on board is to kind of, without bigging myself up in any way, is to kind of put a kind of artistic bubble around them to sort of help them, to mould them, to guide them through to where I'm at. It's a huge responsibility, you know, to... Yes. So, roles that are coming up. There's talk of a Miss Julie in the Littleton.
And what would you be playing in that?
I don't know yet. I mean, obviously not Julie. I'm guessing, because that's coming up quite soon, there might be an understudy role in it there for me somewhere. Which is fantastic in this building. To take advantage of the voice department that they have here, the you know, all the classes that I can do here, movement. You know, I can do, you know, one day I can be doing a vocal class with Patsy Rodenberg, and the next day I can be doing contemporary dance with Javier de Frutos.
So, I think we've established that you're here on a long contract, mm-hmm. Which you've only just begun.
It's brilliant.
Yeah, and somehow the fact that you're not actually performing...
Mm-hmm. For now. In a traditional sense,
is a plus.
Well, it's not a plus. It's interesting. You know, it challenges the form. It asks questions of what an actor is or isn't.
Sorry to interrupt you, but can I ask you what is it you're actually doing now? I mean, now, literally now.
Well, right now.
Yes. Is this some kind of Zen technique?
I'm just gonna lie down. Water?
Yes, I see.
No, would you like some?
No.
I'm going out anyway. Fucking things gone. This is the part of the day where it can start to drag a bit. In the afternoon, you know, getting ready before the punters come in for the show. Essentially, all my work for the day's been done.
I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, that... part of your job description is to do a new thing here of meet and greet people as they come in through
upset the tone.
Through the glass doors. And what is it you have to say to each of them?
Well, there is a script. It's a bit dull.
If you could just sort of let us have a taste maybe of what it is you say.
Well, I'll say, hello, welcome to the National Theatre. The performance will be starting in 20 minutes. Please make full use of the facilities and enjoy the show.
Hmm.
Which is a bit dry.
And is it? Do you have to do that for all three theatres?
Yeah, I'm mainly in the Cottesloe at the moment.
You're mainly in the Cottesloe?
Which is a result, really. It's a bit of a result to be in there, rather than the other houses.
What? Why is that?
Well, because there's 1,500 you have to say hello to, and there's only four in this.
Oh, you don't just generally say hello to everyone?
Oh, no, it's to everybody individually.
Doesn't that slow things down?
No, because people have to pass through. See, this is where you've got to think outside the box. You may feel that what I'm doing there is not part of the production, but it is. It's a very important part of the production. Because who says where the theatre... and the theatrical experience begins and ends. You know, some people would say that it starts with the lights up and people speak in the first lines of the play.
Right.
That's clearly ridiculous.
Whereas you believe it begins...
Well, who knows where it begins? For all intents and purposes for this, it's beginning in the foyer. So it's almost like a happening. So people come in and I immediately... I mean, I don't just say, good evening, welcome to the National Theatre, please make full use of the facilities. Enjoy, have a safe drink. I adopt the tone of the production.
Oh, right.
So if it's a Chekhov,
I
may do an accent.
And do you wear a costume?
No, don't wear a costume. I have a National Theatre t-shirt. But I may adopt, you know, just, I mean, obviously, it's subtle. But it's the merest bit of Ukrainian. In the voice.
Yes.
When I, you know, but very, very subtle. So it's hardly anything at all. You'd hardly notice it when I speak to them.
Yeah.
Got Chekhov tonight, so I should be doing that tonight.
So can you give us an example of this Chekhovian greeting?
Well, it's slightly out of context here, but...
If you need to do any kind of vocal...
No, I don't do any warm-up. I'm already warm. I did a class with the education department earlier on. Okay, so I may go. And again, it'll differ. If it's a cherry orchard, it's going to be very different to Three Sisters. Slightly more angular for the cherry orchard. More thrusting, more new world, more nouveau riche, more new money. Touch of the Roman Abramovich, you know. So in a cherry orchard, it might be, good evening. Welcome to National Theatre. Please make full use of facilities. Have a pleasant evening. Immediately, there's an air of mystery. It's like, what has the play started? Is he an immigrant? Where, you know...
It's very... So, it turns out that actually, once you've done your door greet, you do rush round to the Olivier because you actually are appearing in the Cherry Orchard.
Yeah. Yes.
And if you could let us know, what is it you're playing? Are you playing Piszczek? Are you playing Napachin?
No.
Fears?
No.
Yasha?
No.
What are you playing?
I play a waiter.
A waiter?
Mm-hmm.
There's no scene in a restaurant in the Cherry Orchard.
No. Not traditionally. No.
Ah.
But the second act is set in a modern 20th century, 21st century restaurant.
Really?
Mm-hmm. It's loosely based on the River Cafe in Hammersmith, you know, the... It's about new money. It's about, it suggests an air of nouveau riche, gaucheness, the moving out of the old guard and coming in with a new that may not be tasteful. Lots of people there chatting. We have lots of people dressed as bankers. I don't have any lines as such, but you know, I have to serve a minimum of 3 courses to 25 people. And from the minute I walk to the backstage area, from the backstage area to the Olivier, and my feet virtually don't touch the ground. It's...
You hover?
Well, and I'm not literally, I'm not flying, it's not Peter Pan.
I'm sorry.
No, I mean, I'm talking figuratively.
Ah.
I'm moving so fast that my feet are on fire.
Oh, isn't that a hazard?
So I play the waiter. There is no waiter in the play, so I can't say... I'm bringing an air of... What they tried to get me to do is to bring an air of class, so that we're aware of class.
Ah.
And we're aware of the change.
But isn't the play all about class? Leparkin and Renovskaya?
Not enough. It's not enough.
Would I be... right in saying that actually this is completely untrue?
What's untrue?
Well, you're not playing the waiter in the Cherry Orchard, are you? It's a dream you had.